I'm sure you've all met her. Mike Medica. I'm Nancy Loring. We have some other board members here, but they promised to be mute. I have one question for all of you. How many POA board members does it take to change a light bulb? You're right, none of them. That's not what we do. We're governance. That would be operational. I'm sorry, Cindy. Yes, okay. I got a little quiz for you, and I want you to get comfortable. Just shout out the answer if you know it. Okay? Who owns the beehive? Merle Caldwell owns the beehive.
The building.
I'm talking about buildings here. I'm sorry if that wasn't clear.
It wasn't.
Okay, who owns the beehive?
Merle Caldwell.
There you go. Thank you. All right. Who owns Cordova, or is it Cordova? Up there by the gate, by the Chamber of Commerce building. Who owns Arbus and all those buildings?
Rogers.
Cooper owns Arbus Bank and all of those buildings except for Leffler Dental. And Leffler Dental owns Leffler Dental. Okay. Who owns Dolce Vita and that whole strip there? So, okay, my mom owns this. The person that owns or the corporation that owns that is Liberty. Owns that strip. Who owns Simply Kids, which is now Great Futures?
Boys and Girls Club.
Very good. That's not fair, Kim. Okay. I won't bore you anymore, but I want you to know there's a lot of buildings in the village that the POA has no responsibility for. And if you see those buildings starting to deteriorate, or if you need a coat of paint,
not the beehive.
And a replacement of the beehive, then we need to contact the owners of the buildings. I just thought I'd throw that out.
By we, you mean individually we should call them, or should we ask the board to take care of it?
You could check with the board to see who owns them, and then you could go for it.
And then individually people could contact you.
Certainly.
Say,
why not?
Nancy.
If you think that it's something that needs a little bit of attention, why not?
Could the same thing be true of the famous pothole in the parking lot in front of those Elk in the North that everybody thinks the POA should be responsible for fixing?
No, because that's private property also.
That's my point.
I read that it's over the harbor, but that's not correct.
Question. If we're supposed to go to private businesses and let you complain, if our neighbor's house isn't looking so good, are we responsible to start that conversation?
No. But see, first you have to call the POA to find out who owns these properties, unless you want this list. But no.
But businesses we should contact and private residents we should leave alone.
Well, I know Cindy is wanting to talk here.
I would just report a problem to the POA on a private residence. You don't want to get into conflicts like that.
That's exactly, yes. Report your neighbor to the POA if it really bothers you. No, I don't. I wouldn't report my neighbor to the POA. Let me see. Starter does own, what is it, the Good Spirits across the street.
Starboard.
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 what? SARB, S-A-R-B-E-R, right. Okay. Anyway, Cindy's anxious to get started, and I am too. We're going to hear your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. Very excited to see all of you here, and hope you understand the spirit in which we're trying to hold these events, these town halls that Nancy appropriately labeled Let's Talk. So it is meant to be a dialogue. However, we've got about 20 people who have registered a desire to express a question to this panel. And so we'll get through those first. I'll call them one at a time, and whatever time is left over, then we'll open it to the floor to anybody's questions. We do ask you to ask just one question when it's your turn, and we will be done at straight up 11 o'clock, although I can't speak for the others, but I'm happy to hang around for a little while afterwards and talk individually with you. So happy to have you here. Let's get started. There's a gentleman by the name of William Hoke who has a question about golf.
It's Bill, by the way. Anyway, my question is this. We live close to Bernard Golf Course, and after playing different courses lately, I've noticed that there's car tracks across all the fairways. And I asked the agronomist, why is this being allowed? And he said, because that way we make money. I said, well, who fixes all this later? Well, it's easy to fix. It just doesn't seem right. It's been so wet that the carts get stuck. So, they're sliding in.
Well, he's right. It is easy to fix. And actually, the golfers right now are pretty happy about the fact that they can ride the golf courses. We're an older population. Nobody wants to walk in their cart, including me. But I will say that he told us that in the golf committee that, yeah, they're when the carts go out, they push the grass out, but they can fix that. And by spring, you won't even see it's there. What the real issue is, if you have a cart in the same place and it creates a deep rut, that's a problem to fix. And he doesn't see that right now in what he's looking at. So I believe that the agronomist has helped us to increase golf play because there were many holes before where no carts were allowed. And if it's too wet, you know, I mean, you want to stay, that's an individual thing. If you want to stay on a cart path, walk out to your ball, you can. But a lot of people will just go ahead and drive on out there. And he says it's not a problem to do that. He can fix it.
Okay, great. The next question is from Maxine Klein, and she had a question about golf in our future.
I am pretty concerned about golf. I love golf. I came here because I wanted to play golf. I wanted to fish. I paid extra money because my house is on a lake. I was looking at golf courses also, except when I saw the ball dings in the roof and decided, this is not such a good plan. Switching to lakes. We use a term, subsidized amenities. All of our fun things that we support, we subsidize because they don't break even and they don't make a profit for us. Golf, if you look at it as lost money, we lost $2 million last year. That's the amount of money that we collected from the people who were behind in their dues or not paying at all. We collected $2 million and we lost $2 million. It's a wash. But for the past number of years, we never made a profit. We never broke even on these amenities. So I picked golf because it had the biggest loss. If somebody said, I was running my house at a loss every year. Last year I lost $2 million. Mm-hmm. Something's seriously wrong.
Okay.
So what I would like to see, I'm sure there are people in here who play golf, who love golf, who might actually live at a house that they paid extra for to be on a golf course, believing that if I have to sell this, it's worth more. So, give me one second. On January 10th of this year, the Wall Street Journal put together an article. It's short, I'd like to read it.
Okay, I'm going to pause. I don't know that we'll have time to be reading articles, but I know I've read the article. Have either of you?
No.
Okay. Can you get the gist?
It basically says, across the United States, the problem that we're having here, it's countrywide. And what people have been doing, POAs and HOAs, they said, oh, we have three golf courses. We don't need three. We'll stop two, we'll keep one going. And immediately, the people who bought a property said, I'm not paying assessments.
Right.
I moved on to a golf course to increase business.
Okay, so can we boil this down to a question? I hate to be rude, but we do have several others.
I'd like to suggest that we get together a team of people. And the goal, the reason to form the team is first, to stop the hemorrhage. Second, to break even. Third, to make a profit.
Okay.
So we have to do something different, which is come up with a plan that's goal-oriented, that has timelines, and do it. We've been talking and talking and talking. It's time to start doing. And we can look at what we've done and do something different.
Okay, maybe Mike. Mike serves on the golf committee as the liaison, and so he's the most knowledgeable.
We've had subsidies. I mean, the original developer set everything up here to be subsidized as part of the amenities. We have cut the subsidies. I've been on the board now 5 years. When we started, we were losing, but we have cut the subsidy. Nobody could speak to weather like we had this past year. That was terrible.
I understand.
But we have taken steps. We have created programs to bring people in from the surrounding communities. Yes. We need more golfers. When you start talking about closing golf courses, you are affecting people's wealth. They bought a home there for a reason, and they don't want that their property to go down in what it's worth because, we decide we can't use that golf course. So it's a continual problem, but I believe that we have programs in place. I would like just to see a decent year of weather to see what it brings. For instance, yesterday, Oaklawn added their program talking about Hot Springs Village and what they call it for discovery packages. That'll be in the program every day of the meet. That's a pretty big thing because they had 20,000 people yesterday, and closing day, they're going to have, for Arkansas Derby Day, they're going to have 65,000 to 70,000. We can't reach those people like that. That's a great thing that they've done for us. We signed a contract with them that there's a program where I'll call them their high roller people. If they want to come here and play golf, they can. They don't pay the same price that we pay. It's going to be above that, but they're going to come play. We want to create that program for some people in Denton and other places. So we are trying to cut the subsidies even more than they are today. But I don't know if they're going to get down to zero anytime soon. The other thing is, when you say make a profit, you got to remember, we're a 501c4. We're not a c3, we're a c4. That makes a difference. We have a 60 and 40 expense revenue thing. And you don't want to get outside those boundaries with the U.S. government. It creates problems. There's just a lot of things here people don't understand, believe me. It's very difficult, but I will say this. We made significant strides from when I came on the board when there was no money to do anything to today. We really have. And I'm pleased that we are adding money to the reserves. There were no reserves when I came on the board for 2 years.
Thank you, Mr. Pico.
My only comment to this, I talked to Tom Hepper actually in the parking lot the other day. And he says, "We've got some things up our sleeves." He says, "We're going to have more clinics. We're going to try to get more people in." They're constantly thinking and working to get visitors in here, to increase member rounds. And sorry back there, Bill, but increasing member rounds is driving on the course, believe me. That's one of the things that's helped with us old people that still think we can play ball. So.
And I just wanted to make a comment as well. I think it's appropriate that golf and some of our key amenities experience a subsidy. And the reason I think that's appropriate, as long as it's managed, is because each of us as property owners benefits significantly from the fact that the golf courses are here, even if we are not golfers. I know I am not a golfer, but I'm happy to have a managed portion of my assessments subsidize an amenity that is as important to this village as golf is. And I feel the same way about the fitness center and tennis and other key amenities. So I don't think we ought to pursue necessarily break even by any stretch. I do think we need to manage the subsidy. In preparation for this question, I was just looking at some statistics, and to my finding, the most number of rounds that we ever had played here in the village was in the year 2007, and that was 335,000 rounds. And last year we were at 217,000 rounds. So we do have a volume problem, right? How many golfers do we have? We do need to do all that is necessary to maximize that. What I heard Maxine ask too, though, is we gotta set goals for ourselves and measure ourselves against those goals, and are we achieving what we need to achieve? Mike's right, we had 7% fewer golfable days, if that's a word, golfable days. playable days in 2018 as compared to 2017. But we had a 13% drop in revenue. So there's more to play than just weather. So we need to understand all those drivers and dynamics and figure out what it is we need to do. But 216 versus 335, we've got room for improvement, that's for sure. Okay. Next question, this will be from Connie Courtney. Her question is about bad debts and accounts receivable. Connie is not here. I have no idea what her question might be then. That's all she put. Bad debts and account receivable. Okay, Craig Johnson. Craig asks, what is the, quote, agreement to serve and how it works? Do you want to elaborate?
Just going through a lot of the documents, it seemed that there's this whole obedience concept. The obedience, the board members have to, have obedience. And there's all kinds of articles and stuff to do it. In reading back, Harp Shelton one time apparently had suggested some kind of an agreement or something, and then the lawyer said, "Well, then why do you just have some kind of an agreement to serve that the board members all sign?" And I was kind of struck by that because it seemed, and I don't know if you do that or not. Okay, but the same sort of things are in these board member duties, and it seems to me it's chilling. It looks like, I think the effect of all this stuff is, I understand the board wants to have a united front. We decide something, we all support it. On the other hand, it makes it, I don't want to be blunt, but it makes you look like puppets. Who's the puppeteer? Because you go into the room and everybody comes out and they're all agreeing. There's no discussion, there's no dissent. And it just is sort of a chilling thing to me, that's all. And the last item on this, what I found especially chilling, this is from the board member duties.
What he's referring to is from the bylaws, which is a governing document that is an expression of the members' desires for governing the board.
Yeah, and the last, very last one, number 17, is to consider resigning my position as a board member if for any reason I find myself unable to carry out my fiduciary responsibilities, care, loyalty, and obedience. And I think some of the things you guys have to live by, it has a bad effect. It makes, like I say, it makes it look like it's secret. I'd like to see some of you guys disagree from time to time. And in a sense, the last, you know, the last group that got on, I think a lot of people voted for you guys because we know you. And we thought you would be a strong voice in opposition to some stuff, and we still hear the strong voice.
Okay, fair enough. Well, I would like to address loyalty, obedience, and duty of care, which are the fiduciary responsibilities, but I'd also love to hear Mike talk about. He served when Harv was working on that section of the bylaws. So, as board members, we do have what's called a fiduciary responsibility. Here's what I'll acknowledge to everybody. There's some words around here that have proven to be a bit toxic. I know fiduciary is one of those, but since you brought it up, I'm going to address it and then move on. But it is a toxic word, and I get that. But nonetheless, it is a legal reality for us. And the fiduciary responsibility includes three elements. One is duty of care, one is loyalty, and one is obedience. So let me explain those just a little bit. The duty of care obligates us as board members to not just be passive approvers or deniers of any issue that comes before us. We have an obligation to do due diligence to understand whether what's being proposed is for the good of the organization. We can't just passively not invest our time or effort to understand the issue, understand the dynamics of it. We have a duty of care to work our absolute hardest to make that best possible decision. That's what duty of care is. Loyalty is not what you think it is. Loyalty means that if an issue is presented to the board where, as a board member, I have to choose between, is this better for the beehive or is this better for the POA, my loyalty obligation, my fiduciary responsibility is I have to choose what is best for the organization. I have to do that. I cannot let any personal agenda color my opinion on that or color my decision on that. I have to be loyal to the association and not loyal to anything that's not the association as my role as board member. We ought to all be thankful that I and every other board member is liable, legally liable to do that. And the obedience one is not what you think it is either. The obedience fiduciary responsibility is that we have to be obedient to the documents and laws that govern us. So when we say we can't do something because policy or bylaws or articles of incorporation or declaration won't allow us, it's not because we don't think we have a better idea. It's because we have to be obedient to the documents that govern this association. And that's what obedience is. It has nothing to do with behind the scenes, you know, being loyal to the CEO, being loyal to anything else. That's what obedience, loyalty, and duty of care are. So others can speak.
No, you get in there and then I won't say much.
Well, what she stated is right. I tell you one thing, we don't have secret meetings. I've never been in a meeting where you have three or more people where anything is ever secret anyway. It just doesn't happen. We don't make decisions, we get updates. This place is huge. It is so big. We're 50 years old, it's 26 square miles. A lot of this stuff was put in 40, 45 years ago. Stuff creeps every day. We have to be aware of that. We have to understand what's going on everywhere. We don't have time to bring in the public to listen to that because it's just an update that we're getting, trying to figure out where we stand on certain issues. We also get things coming in that the board has to understand only for the board's ears because if it gets out in public, it may be harmful. And it's just, you know, that's why we're on the board. That's why we have the responsibility that we make sure that we don't discuss those things in public. And some of them never go anywhere. Some may, you never know. But this place is, it's quite a place. It really is. No matter what happens, you can be sure that for the amount of people we have and what's going on here every day, it takes a lot of effort. It really does. We've got people in the POA that have been in there for 20, 30, 40 years, and that's, let me tell you, I've had somebody tell me, well, why, they're not gonna go anyplace, they can't go any higher, who cares? They do a job, which we have difficulty bringing people in from the outside. We are a gated community, and it's hard to bring in help. It really is. We face the same problem that Hot Springs and Benton and Bryant and Little Rock face. It's just hard to find the people that you need to do the job, so that's my take.
And to your original point, we do not sign anything swearing that we're going to be good little boys and girls and agree with everybody. We do sign for indemnity, and that's just because my pocket's not quite that deep if I would get sued. And the rest is the same way. It's for protection for potential legal matters. Mike is absolutely right. I was amazed when I came on board how complex this village is. And we just take it for granted. You know, the toilet's flushed, the water comes out of the faucet, we can play golf, we can go to the tennis and play tennis, we can play pickleball. We just take those things for granted because they're right here in our backyard. But somebody's got to take care of all that. And as Mike says, something breaks every day because it's old, just like we do.
Sorry about that.
Yes.
I want to make a brief comment. I think I've been here about 10 years. Recently, in the last few years, the board has emphasized corporations. And as you said, some of those words are toxic. So if I knew those words were toxic, I wouldn't mind using them. We are a community. And that's the way that people want to hear from the board, as a community. We're residents here. We're not stockholders. And I'm an accountant. So there's lots of different forms you can file with the IRS. We don't give a rat's banana about that. We're a community. And that's the way we want to be treated. And I think that's when the board is kind of going wrong.
I can't agree with that.
You know, I think that's an important point, and I would agree with you, and I hope you find that today's event starts feeling more community-oriented than corporate-oriented, I hope. The second thing is, you're right, I wouldn't have brought up any of that had it not been inherent in the question that was asked, because I too believe that we have those legal obligations, but we don't need to put them front and center, as that is what causes us to do what we do all the time. In my estimation, I'm only speaking as a single director, we got to conduct ourselves in a community way until and unless it conflicts with our legal obligations. Not start with our legal obligations and then try to work in community. See what I'm saying? I think our priority ought to be community, with a full knowledge as a board member that we do have these legal responsibilities. The other thing I want to say about secret meetings, there's been a slight change in the board meetings. We have executive sessions every month that I've been a board member now. And what has happened in the board meeting minutes, or in the agenda, it has said that an executive session took place. We have adjusted that to say now that an executive session took place, and we say what it was that was discussed in the executive session. What you'll see there is the reason for that meeting will be articulated in the bylaws. It's going to be one of those bylaw things that allows us to meet in executive session, whether it's a legal issue, a personnel issue, a contractual issue, whatever that issue is, we will say why it is we met in executive session. What happens in executive session, the very first thing the chair does is say, I'd like to make a motion to move into executive session for purposes of discussing X, Y, and Z. Then as board members, we have to vote and say, yes, that's an appropriate use of an executive session. So it's seconded, it's approved, and then we go into executive session. So it's always for a very explicit purpose that is outlined in the bylaws.
I'm sorry, this is getting longer than probably we wanted to get. I hope everyone gets the e-blast and is aware of the things that we're attempting to do now that maybe should have been done a long time ago, but at least there's a start. This is one of the town hall meetings. We're hoping for a budget process improvement, so more people are involved and know what's going on with that. The CMP Advisory Committee, which is going to be made up of many diverse opinions across the community, so that it, we can hear the people through those people. Videos of all the board meetings, we can thank Larry for that back there. Some things are going to be live streamed. The next forum is going to be live streamed, and there's been many, many views. I don't know the numbers right now, but you said it was quite a few. It was like 300 the last time I looked.
Over 5.
It's up to 5, along with the people that actually attended the forum. We want to have more open debates in public. You want to hear us talk. We've decided that even though we know why we say yes, we need to verbalize why we say yes to you. We need to verbalize why we say no to you on a specific motion. And that's something that we're working toward. We're working toward these things, and I think the entire board is in agreement that it's long overdue and really needed.
Okay, the next person, I'm going to call on Evelyn, but she said her question, she wasn't sure what it was yet. Is Evelyn here? Evelyn, what's your question?
My question is, I've been reading that they're going to put in kayak launchings, and I'm wondering if they can be made accessible for people with disabilities. Now, some people have that I've mentioned that say, well, what does that entail? And I've just looked on the internet and seen where they come to a B, they don't tip over, you have some railings, and I'm just wondering, I think it would help a lot of people continue to kayak if there was an easier way to get in and out of one.
I'm the liaison to the Recreation and Trails Committee. Anything's possible with money.
It doesn't look that expensive to me.
Well, they are. They're about $30,000 or $40,000. They are in the plans at some point. One would possibly be at Waypoint. If we had more money, they might be placed in other places. But right now, that's something that's in the CMP, but it is a disabled kayak launch where it lowers into the water. I mean, I'm not going to tell you what I look like getting in and out of a kayak, but this is perfect for people that have maybe a balance problem, or just anything else. But it's in the works. It's been thought about. It just, anything's possible with money. So as money permits, those kind of amenities will be brought out.
Okay, Bruce Smith. Is Ruth here? I have a friend named Bruce Smith.
Pickleball group that's coming in this month, get to them.
invite them back, give them a goodie, entice them to come back. People love the village when they come, but we do nothing. Even the real estate people miss these people. I could not believe that we missed such an opportunity, and we must be missing it. We missed that one, 500 people. We must be missing a lot of people that are coming in. Get somebody assigned to what activities are coming and what can we do to get them back here again. They might not do much that weekend, they're busy with their activities. Bring them back.
They're here.
Yeah, I'm going to say, I agree with what you said for the most part. I do know that we're going to keep track, for instance, of the agreement we signed the vote on for the golfers. We're going to find out how many are coming in. And there's other things that we need to do like that. It takes, you know, I mean, I'm not real up on the IT that we have. I hate to say it that way, but I have an IT background, and there's a lot of things that you can put together, but you gotta have somebody who can do it. It's a private community. Our IT doesn't go far enough.
We've put 27 more members on full-time salary, which means they get benefits and everything else. 27 members, 10% more than we had before. Our POA employment members are down, but our salary, full-time salary members are up. Give them the job.
Your comments.
We're not even back to what it was when Scott Randall came in here.
Okay, Tommy Williams, I got to meet a little earlier. Happy to hear from you, and he just says his questions about the POA. That's a big topic.
Well, it's kind of wrong, isn't it? When I filled that form out, I didn't know exactly what I was going to ask, but I knew it had something to do with POA. A lot of you may know the answer to this question, but I ask this for the people who don't. Tom Weiss is leaving. He's the board president. And so we're going to have to elect a new board president. So my question is, what is the process by which the board goes about electing a president? And is this going to happen prior to the new board members coming in? And will Leslie be involved in this decision?
Would you like to answer? But it happens right after they're installed. The new board members are installed, and they're definitely included in the election of the chairman and the vice chairman. Leslie is not a voting member of the board. She is allowed to participate, and she is presently the board corporate secretary. But she and Liz Mathis, the board corporate treasurer, do not have votes. The 7 board members you elected have votes. The 3 new ones that come on board will have a vote also as to who the chairperson is and the vice chair.
Yeah, that's essentially it. It's no longer a board president, it's a board chairman. And the board elects their chairman and vice chairman and secretary and treasurer. But that happens immediately after the new board members are seated, just like Nancy said.
Didn't you say that Leslie was the secretary for the?
She is.
So how could she be, and she's not a member of the board, so how could she say?
No. The board, the 7 elected members of the board choose the chair, the vice chair, the secretary, and the treasurer.
From anyone?
From any board member. From any board member.
But for Leslie Nally, or I'm not against Leslie Nally or anybody, but if she's an employee and not on the board, how can you elect her as secretary?
Because the officers do not need to be elected board members.
Okay.
So it's just the officer positions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So anyone can be elected chairman or vice chairman?
Anyone that serves on the board.
Okay. But the secretary and treasurer do not have to serve on the board.
They are non-voting board members.
They have no vote.
non-voting board members. There's seven voting board members that are elected by the population and two non-voting board members, being the CEO and CFO. And they serve the elected role of secretary treasurer, but it's the board that elects them to that.
So they can be involved in the discussion of who's going to be elected chairman?
No, they can't.
Not.
They're not going to be involved in anybody elected.
It's a matter of vote. If I'm on the board, I make a motion to have Cindy as the chairperson. Somebody's going to second it, then we just take a vote. It's that simple.
There could be more than one person selected. We might have two or three people selected to be chair. Take a vote on each one. It could run into quite a time.
The only thing I wanted to add is that Leslie and Liz, as participating board members and officers of the board, are also included in any email that goes to the board members in total, okay? So if you think that Leslie's not getting that message, or in this case now Liz Mathis is not getting that question or that comment, they are included in that distribution. When you send an email to the board members, hsvpoa.org, nine people will get that email, okay?
It's important to know. No, that's right.
Okay, good question, good to clear up. Melinda, you have a question about marketing?
Of course.
I do. Of course, marketing, of course.
I do, you're my art. The CEO reported this month that we closed out in 2018 with 58 new homes. That number might have been adjusted, I'm not sure. 28 POA owned lots closed and 39 discovery packages. To me personally, this doesn't move the needle at all. My question is, are you all satisfied with these numbers? Are you satisfied with our current marketing, that is advertising and promotional efforts? If yes, please explain why. If no, what should we be doing? As a board member, have you expressed your thoughts on marketing to the CEO? And lastly, to your knowledge, who manages our marketing efforts? Thanks.
Well, I'll start. I mean, Leslie manages the marketing program. Nobody's satisfied with what we got.
She has absolutely
One of the issues that I think is out there today is it's not like when Cooper started, where he brought a lot of people in, put them in place, gave them free rounds to go off and had them down here. The attention span of people today is very short. I hate to say it, but it is. I think that some of the marketing we're doing today on IT, or this thing with Oaklawn, reaches a lot larger base than wherever you reach bring a bunch of people down. And I think that's a start in the right direction. We went 3 years on the board, we hardly built any homes. And I think the last figure we had for last year was, what, 63 buildings? Hello?
He's on his phone.
It was 59 reported. You're talking about 2018?
Yeah.
It was 59 reported, and then I believe.
One of the things on there that I was surprised about is the packages. We had 39? Six of those became home builders. They're going to build homes here. That's a pretty good percentage for that low of volume. So there may be some future in that down the road. But it is, again, we're an older community, and marketing today is so much different than I think it was in the old days, but that's me, maybe. Other people have different opinions. I just, we need to reach as broad a base as possible. I once said, I'd like to see us send out something to all the major companies in the country and the military saying, we're here, this is an older retirement community and you can move here. Because when I retire, I don't know anything. I mean, I had to drive up here one year and saw this place. That's how I became a 100% Village resident. Second time I came up here, I brought my wife, she liked it, and moved here eventually. We owned a townhouse to start with, and then we bought a house. But there are so many people in the retirement age and companies that they're working all every day, and they're not even thinking about what they're going to do when they retire. Well, we need to reach those somehow, in some shape or form, whether it's through IT or some other thing. And I don't know how that's going to happen, but marketing is always difficult. Everybody has different ideas on marketing.
Any other board members or comments?
Yes.
Take turns.
Yeah, we're all going to talk about this one probably. This was Cooper's original ad. I mean, I can even pass it around if you want. I kind of want it back. But people thought that we were a retirement community. When in 1970, Cooper wanted everybody here. And when I came here, everybody was here. I mean, all different ages were here. That was 16 years ago. I'm with you, Melinda. We need maybe a little bit more aggressive marketing that I guess we can see. I know that there's a lot of work being done. I'm with Mike on the fact that I think it's amazing that 6 of the 39 discovery packages converted, because the time limit was 12 to 24 months that you would have some sort of a turnover from that type of a thing. And this has been, what, less than a year? Has it been less than a year that program has been in place? So that's pretty good. That means the village does sell itself once you get people here. And we need to work on that more. I'll put in a plug for Leslie's next forum. I believe it's going to be on marketing. I think that's what people want to hear. They want to hear what's being done and what the plan is. Also in the past, there's been some aggressive marketing. NPRI, we now have over 11,000 delinquent lots. The POA owns 3,200 lots. Maybe that aggressive marketing is not so good. You busload people in and you keep the shutters down on the bus so they can't see any other sign. You bring them in, you wine and dine them, and you show them just what you want to show them. It increased the prices of our lots. It destabilized our little market right here in the village. And again, that's why we have 11,000 delinquent lots to the tune of approximately $5 million a year. We don't want to sell 34,000 lots and have people build houses on them. We wouldn't be able to move in this village. Maybe twice the size we are would just be magnificent. So we need to approach this in a more conservative way than maybe in the past. That's all I can say about it.
The CMP calls for 2,500 new developed lots over the next 20 years, which would average about 125 a year, which at 58 or 59, we're well short of that. Half of that. So no, I don't think anyone is satisfied at that rate. As Nancy mentioned, Leslie is doing a Forward Together forum. I believe it's scheduled for February 11th. The topic will be marketing, and we should all plan to attend that. Here's the kind of thing I'm going to be listening for, because as we were working with Leslie and talking about the focuses for the coming year, three themes emerge. One is marketing, one is revenue generation, and one is managing our deferred maintenance. But marketing made the top three, so we're going to be hearing a lot about that. What I'm going to be listening for in the February 11th Forward Together forum that I think is important for this village is we need a marketing strategy. I mean, this is a strategic issue for the village. We can't go from 58 developed homes to 125 on average without a strategy for getting there. We need a plan which says by this date, we're going to market to these people using these methods. We need a plan, a marketing plan. Haven't seen one yet. I don't know that it exists or doesn't. We get a lot of anecdotal, and Mike pointed out some very good anecdotal evidence that we're doing some marketing, but I don't know what the plan is, and I certainly don't know what the strategy is. But key to all of that is there's an open position right now that is a community marketing manager, and that person hasn't been hired yet. Those are critical things, a strategy, a plan, and who's going to be leading the effort. So those are the things that I'm going to be listening for on February 11th, and will inform my decision making as we go forward, addressing marketing as one of our top three issues for 2019.
I'd like to say one other thing from a board member perspective.
You lost it.
I guess.
I
lost it a long time ago. From a board member perspective, I'd like to say one thing. You know, there's a lot of things board members have to do. You have to understand, we live in two counties. Okay, so we got Saline County on one end, Garland on the other. We attend a lot of functions in those counties. Those counties have people who want to know what's going on in Hot Springs Village. When you look at some of the things we have to work on, we have board members working on getting bypassed through here, having the highway department do things with the infrastructure on the outside. It's a lot of effort. It's not just what happens in Hot Springs Village that we have to work on. It's the things on the outside too, because people driving here want to drive on good infrastructure. They don't want to see bad roads. Anytime you see something bad driving, it stays with people. So it's from our perspective, come Monday, we're going up to, some of us are going up to Little Rock to meet with the legislature. There are things that are legislative people. There are things going on that recently, broadband is a big issue in Hot Springs Village. Very little the board can do about that, because broadband is controlled by utility companies, and we don't own the right-of-ways in a lot of instances, and that's an issue. But we are attempting to at least lay the groundwork to try to get some of those things here. And that's, again, the board is not just having a meeting every month and doing what comes out of the POA. From a decision standpoint, we spend time outside doing the same thing. You have to. We cannot be an island by ourselves, not with two counties. So we got to work with those people, and they want to work with us. I mean, we and the GAC, the meeting we had recently, I think if you looked at, you saw that we had Mayor Benton here. Some stuff that came out of that was they like to work with us closer. They did compliment Hot Springs Village because we helped pass the CTE site for them, and that's a big deal for Benton. They're really appreciative for the voters of Hot Springs Village. But I don't want to, you cannot think that the board is just there to do things in Hot Springs Village. We are, but there's a lot of other things that have to go with it.
One final comment I would make on marketing, and I meant to say this during my comments, is my background is as an accountant, and I'm very comfortable with numbers and measuring success or lack of success based on results, measurable results. So I think that's another key that I would be looking for in the marketing strategy and in the plans, is how are we going to measure that our expenditure of our marketing dollars has been successful or not? What are those key metrics? So I meant to mention that in my comments, and I apologize that I didn't. Next person up is Bill Joden. The topic is building trust between board and property owners. Bill, are you here?
I am.
Oh, okay.
Hi. My wife and I, good morning. My wife and I moved here recently. In fact, tomorrow we will have been here 1 year. We love the job. It meets so many of our needs. But we are a little concerned that there seems to be a lot of friction. And that what we're seeing with the voting, where everything was voted down, and we're just wondering, as we talk to people, we get a lot of opinions on how good this is and how lost we are, how much its value is, and how we're just not getting things done right. So my question is, basically, in light of the voting, where all issues were voted down, how did that hit the board, and what is the board doing to build this trust that we're talking about, where we're all moving forward together instead of pulling apart?
Well, I think things like this help that issue. It was never, from a personal standpoint, it was never going to be easy to pass the declaration change, because obviously the original developer didn't want that to happen. The reason we did that was we were trying to protect ourselves against more property being brought into the village than we have today. We didn't want that. It's just, from my standpoint, we're just going to go on. We're going to try to have as many of each type of meetings as we can to get more. You have to have more communications up there. We need to get as much information out to the people as we possibly can. And that's what we've been trying to do. May not be what everybody wants to hear or do, but it's what we believe is the right direction. We're property owners just like you and everybody else in here. And we face the same things, so.
So you were not surprised that they were all voted down?
Not really.
No, if you want to, just be surprised.
I said when we put the thing together, it was going to be difficult. Because you got the original developer, but he didn't want that. The problem I have with the whole thing is, in 2007, this is something that really came to me anyway. When Cooper, the original developer, pulled out.
I was here in 2007.
He left us, and we didn't hear anything for, 11 years?
Right. Now keep in mind that was the bottom fell out. Yeah. At Rosedale,
every place.
I understand. But I think when we took over, we always had the original developer, he made a lot of decisions.
Yeah. Yes.
And when we took over, it was something like...
It was hard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's taken us... It's taken us
a long
years.
Time to come to speed. And
but we shouldn't be expressing good guy, bad guy sentiments.
Right.
Anymore. That needs to go away.
We all voted, not just the developer.
Exactly.
Yeah. Oh, no. We are the POA.
Yeah.
We are the POA, not the solar group up on the hill. We are the POA. And if you blame CCI for this, then
I'm not blaming CCI. What I'm saying is that we wanted, when it was first put together, we wanted to protect more property being built.
Okay, will you explain what that means? Because I have no idea what you just said. More property. That was one declaration.
Okay. That's reserve property.
Okay.
He owns a reserve property. Still quite a bit.
Where is it?
It's called 100 acres.
But didn't that same declaration allow the POA to bring in property if they wanted to?
Yes, it did.
All right, so that might have been the point that some people didn't like.
Right. Excuse me, Mike, if I interrupt here. I think the question was how we, the board, can gain your trust again. And We need your help. We need your help to come to the right decisions. We're doing these kinds of things, which I think hasn't been done since maybe Linda Maywood was interim director, or interim general manager, or whatever. And I know everybody enjoyed those coffees. I know Chief Middleton has coffees with the chief, and everybody loves those. The attendance was down the last time, and there were donuts, so we're disappointed in that. How do we gain your trust again? Because honestly, we're just trying to do the best job we can. And it goes back to those toxic words.
Yeah.
That it's not what I personally want. I would love to have my cul-de-sac repaved. But it's not going to happen just because I'm on the board. And it's something that I can't even mention because I'm on the board. We have to be ethical. We have to follow the federal laws, the state laws, the Articles of Incorporation, the Declaration, as it stands today and as it stood before that particular vote, the policies and the bylaws. We have to follow those rules as board members. You guys don't really have to. You really don't have to. But you tell us what we can do to gain your trust. Besides have these meetings on Saturday morning, we're going to have another one the 21st of February. It's going to be at the other end of the village because we want to try and make it ourselves as available as possible to everyone in the village. We were hoping we'd see some working families, some working people that would come because we've got younger people on this end of the village. We've got a lot of kids on this end of the village. We were hoping maybe that would spur some interest, and maybe the next time it will. So as a result of the trust issue,
this is my building trust. You get your copy back.
Thank you so much. You're new to the village, so.
Yeah.
but really, give us some solutions. Give us some hints on how we can gain trust. And it doesn't mean that we gain trust by your demands. Okay? I don't know who started.
If I could just for a moment, because I do want to open it up to a room dialogue, but I'd like to make my comments first before we do, because I took it very seriously, that vote. To me, it was apparent that it would not have mattered what we put in front of the village. The village was upset with us, with regard to the CMP, was upset with us with regard to the quality of our decision making, our different issues. So here's how I handled the situation. Is a few days after that vote was done, I sent out an email, a blind email, to 15 of what I consider my trusted advisors. These are people that even when they don't agree with me or I don't agree with them, I very much value their ability to tell me what's up and not sugarcoat it. So I sent out to 15, one of them is in this room, by the way. I sent out this email and I said, let me have it. What happened here? What do I need to take away from this vote? What do I need to do as a board member differently? What do I need to understand that maybe I don't understand? Where's my blind spots? And I got, almost all of them got back to me. And I looked at their responses and it came up to three things for me. One is we have to increase our transparency. Yes. That was one theme that came strong from these people. A second theme that came strong is improve the quality of our decision making, right? We can't afford to have decisions that don't come about in the right way or are based on flawed thinking. We need to improve that. And the third topic that came is better property owner engagement. We need to open ourselves in dialogue with the property owners. We need to find out
We can't lease the, we can't wait for our property owners to weaponize the vote to try to get us to wake up to what it is they're trying to tell us, frankly. I think those are the three areas. So, my ideas on transparency that I came up with, and some of them you'll see already bearing fruit, financials presentation, business case presentation, you will see in the very few coming ones that Liz is going to be working on presenting our financial data in a more understandable and more directed to the goals and the interests of the organization. She's going to be recommending changes to financial presentation so that it's better understood by not only the board but the community. Meeting videos posted online by the POA. We're doing it today. We've been doing it for a few weeks now. Monthly updates on all board-approved open projects. So if the board approves a project, then every month, staff is going to be giving us an update on, is that project progressing? Is it on time? Is it on budget? Is it delivering what it's intended to deliver? We've started that now. We're recommitting to open debate on all spending motions. And what we mean by that is, I think people want to hear us actively debate whenever we're spending your money. More so, maybe, than just a policy change here or there that maybe is a little bit more ethereal. When we're spending your money, you want to hear a robust discussion on that. So we're recommitting to that. As I mentioned earlier, labeling each executive session as to its purpose, so you don't have to wonder why it is we went into executive session. I'm going to skip a couple until we have opportunity to talk about it as a board, but I would like to see us have more complete information on governance pages on the website. You know, let's look at, you know, what were the minutes from last year and the year before? You know, just once those documents become public, let's keep them preserved on a website. I'm going to set aside that for a moment. The quality of our decision making. I think we need to improve our budgeting process. And you'll see in February, there will be a proposal from the governance committee to the board to consider some changes in how the budget comes together. I think that will be definitely an improvement. In terms of property owner engagement, what we're doing today is the first of what we hope to be monthly. We're committed to doing this one and the February 21st Let's Talk Town Hall at Granada in the afternoon at 2 o'clock. We're committed to doing those two, and with your feedback, we'll determine whether we continue doing them. We hope so. If it proves not valuable to the community, we'll stop, but we hope that those will continue. I think that is, I think that's the primary ones that I'm prepared to talk about without first discussing with the board. But I just want to say that's how I went about hearing what it is you said, by asking 15 of my trusted advisors, asking them to give me ideas and feedback, and I'm committed to try to push those forward.
Yes, definitely. I just want to add another thing that we tossed around, and this was education. Education, I don't know how many people would come, they might sleep through it, depending on the time of the day, but let's have an open discussion on the bylaws, or let's have an open discussion on policies. Let's talk about where you can find those things, what they mean. There's so much half-truths and mistruths and misinterpretations out there that I think it's really needed. And also, people just don't bother. I'd rather listen to my neighbor, because they're pretty smart. They know what's going on. So I'm going to listen to them instead of going to that document and reading it. So I don't know if that's something, if you've got these little cards on your table to offer suggestions, if that's something you think would be good, put it down there, because we may try to do some of those. Questions?
I don't think any anybody would not want to applaud your efforts. I mean, honestly, you give a lot. But in reality, I think the opportunity for trust is going to have to wait for the new board. I think it's too little, too late to get that slam of 60-40. That's a real slam. And I don't think it was Cooper. I think the lightning rod was the board. That's my opinion.
Is there any other question?
Yeah, I think you hit on the head. Do you want to build trust? Put the CMP up for a vote of everybody. When the board before you guys went on, the last thing they did was approve that CMP, and then you were put in. People voted for you guys because they didn't like what was going on, in my opinion. And once that happened, it's like the trust just went out the window.
The only comment I can have to that is that there are 7 people on the board, and the reason you might have noticed there's only 3 panelists here. We did not want a quorum of board members here. We've got a quorum, but they're being really good and quiet. But we did not want a quorum because we can't make a decision individually.
Right.
Okay, and that's...
I'm not asking you to do it. I'm saying, figure, because you're not going to do that. I mean, that's silly, but that's the concept. In my mind, that's where it went south in a big way when that last board voted it in, right, without you guys being able to even discuss it.
And bless the 10 people that are running for the board, because they're going to need your blessings. But also, don't expect miracles out of them the first day they get on the board. I mean, don't expect them to, I don't know, do whatever it is you really think is important that first day or that first month or the first 3 months or the first 6 months. Okay? Spence, have
I'm assuming that our contract with Troon has an expiration date, and I'm wondering if there's a process in place to judge whether we want to renew that contract. The same question would be applied to our contract with our front end back end security people.
Since we're still on the trust topic, I have other questions to call people on. So at the moment, we're talking on the trust issue, and I want to exhaust that issue with all of you first before we move on. And then when we have time, we'll continue.
The trust issue.
Yes, ma'am.
Why is the amount of money that we pay True not available to us? How can you explain to me why I can't know what it's costing me for True to bring in all these golf people, which evidently hasn't happened as much as you might have liked?
Mm-hmm. Any property owner has the right to examine the contracts in Leslie's office, so you're welcome to do that. If your question, though, is a question of why aren't the contracts made public so everybody can... Okay, all right, then if that's not your question, then yes, just call Leslie and make an appointment to examine the contracts.
And she can tell me how much we have paid for them to be here, because we've not been able to get that information.
Well,
normal.
Okay, let's back up. The answer to the question is yes, we still have the contract. It's in up at the end of 2019. Yes, we will evaluate whether we want to continue to do it or not. When the contract was signed, Troon asked us to sign a non-disclosure agreement.
Okay, but why? That's my question.
It's
not how much it costs, but why?
Why Troon asked that?
Why it even happened that way? I don't.
It happens in business, in government, all the time.
It does, and it's a competitive matter, because they need to be able to keep their negotiations with us and their contractual obligations with us out of the sight of other organizations with whom they contract. So it's appropriate, but I want to make certain everybody understands that any property owner has the right to ask Leslie to show them the contract, and you too will be asked to sign non-disclosure. Yeah, Pat?
Just to make one other thing in the same category, the trees that were cut for the storage unit on Balearic, and you recall that one?
Yes.
And everybody in the village noticed it, and they weren't supposed to do it, and it was common property. And then there was ultimately, after a long time, a settlement made. And I get why, but if I was on the board or if I was part of the POA, I wouldn't let somebody make me keep that private. These people want to know what the settlement is.
Okay, but this, that was a lawsuit. Okay? There, his attorneys made us sign the agreement, or they weren't going to do anything. And we wanted to settle it. It was a non-disclosure.
You know, there's just some things.
Well, what good does it do to let everybody know what happened?
Because that's where you, that, but a lot of that has happened, and that's why people feel the way they do. When you say, we can't tell you this.
Well, the problem is, we had that lawsuit for a couple of years, okay? And if we finally got to the point with all our lawyers and theirs in the room to settle it, and they wanted not all of us to sign non-disclosures not for the
I understand all of that. I understand that.
I don't understand what your question is.
Yeah, what I don't understand is how you get it across to people that it's good for them, but I can't tell you any of it. You know what I mean?
Maybe the cost is too much. That's the effect of that. Maybe you should say, no, we're not signing that.
Yeah, but then there's not much more.
We don't have the amount of money, so what are you talking about? Maybe it costs more in the lack of trust than we got in the way of the
settlement. Yeah, exactly.
All I'm going to say is, I don't like lawsuits, period. The longer they go on, the only reason we make the money is the lawsuits.
Well, in that same regard, I got up at one of the meetings and said, hey, if we had put a mediation clause in relation to the gate thing, maybe we'd be in a better position than we are now with a lawsuit. You get into a lawsuit because of something that happened that you didn't anticipate, and maybe there's a way today to anticipate. I'm not judging it. I'm just saying it'd be a lot better off if we were doing some kind of arbitration or something to get a settlement rather than some lawsuit where we're going to spend a bunch of money.
Okay, who else has a comment with regard to the trust issue? Yes, sir.
Question I have is, how much are we paying the CEO, the CFO, and the top executives that we have no idea how much we're paying?
That is a litigation matter as well, isn't it? When that emerged as a hot topic among property owners, it wasn't long after that became a hot topic that we found ourselves the subject of a lawsuit. Precludes what we can do for the time being. I think it's an issue that needs to be addressed ultimately, but we need to know where the court's going to land on it first before we take any action at all. We just can't talk about it any further, unfortunately. Also, it goes back to those policies. A policy that was created in 1976 by Cooper, mainly because, I don't know mainly because I wasn't here, I can't get in his head, but it was created in 1976 that personnel information is confidential and not to be shared with the membership. Okay. That's what we have to go by. It was updated in 2018 by a word, but the crux of that policy was in place in 1976. Our fiduciary duty as board members is to say we have to follow that policy. It's part of governing documents.
Change the policy.
Yes, we can change the policy, but we're in, no, policies have nothing to do with 7 years, so we need to understand that, right? The declaration is locked in for 7 years. But policies, you're right, the board can change the policy at any time. But this flared up and immediately went to a lawsuit, nearly immediately, before any reasonable board could say, hey, we've got something to address here. I think we're going to need to address the policy, but we've got to let it play on the courts first, unfortunately. But that's where that is.
Is a compensation ratio to our assessments, is that, I think right now it's around 45-47%, is that historically in line with what it was back 5-10 years ago?
You know, I think the whole compensation topic is worthy of a beaver dive, without a doubt. But what I would caution anybody against is looking on trends on compensation, because we insource and outsource, and part-time and full-time changes over time, right? I mean, they outsourced payroll administration, and then they outsourced the gate. Security and all of that. It's a cost, without a doubt, but it's not as easy as just comparing compensation over time. So, but it is worthy of a deeper dive.
I'm not necessarily worried about how much money Liz is making. I'm more worried about how much money we're spending on compensation.
Right.
So, maybe a follow up question to that is there any archivable data where I could find that back 5 or 10 years ago? We used to keep all that from our meetings, but you know, that kind of dropped off about 5 years ago.
I think this is my comment earlier. I think what we need to do is make it available for a longer period of time.
It's not available on the old website and archives or anything.
Not that I'm aware of. No. Who else?
This lady here, please.
I'm sorry.
My name is Missy Masterson Hale. I'm a 21-year resident of the village. Came here at, like a lot of people, I think, for one of the free weekends 1,000 years ago. And moved here 8 years later. So a seed was planted, but I had little bitty kids at the time. It was not the right time. One of the things about this village that I think a lot of people feel is this is a point of light. We even have a sign out there at the gate that says we are. I think we're here because we like this better than any place else we've seen. Is it perfect? No. But trust goes two ways. Not only do we have to trust you that you're doing your fiduciary responsibility and you're listening to us and you're being responsive to us. And I think you're doing a good job of that with this venue this morning. It's much better than a ginormous thing. I think this is great and a great move in the right direction. But you have to be able to trust us too, that we will honestly give you feedback in a respectful and polite manner. The thing that saddens me the most is to see these side discussions on email and next door and all that, where they're just vicious. Mm-hmm. I don't know who raised these folks, but my grandmother taught me you do not have to be disagreeable to disagree. And when you are, you diminish your own credibility. And I am just calling for us not to follow the trends that we see in the rest of the United States and actually around the world, where people just go from zero to rabid in 60 seconds and they launch personal attacks and they throw trash in people's yards and all this garbage. That's not who we are here. Let's set a tone for the rest of the world for intelligent, polite, respectful discourse. That's all I want to say. Thank you.
And I can't have any say so because I'm on the board.
Yes, sir.
I would love to hug you on this.
You got it.
Yes, sir, in the back.
My name is Joe Decker. I've been here 2 years, so I'm not as long as others, but it kind of dovetails what she was saying. I've seen so many, in my opinion, letters in the voice that have misinformation from my perspective again, but I almost never see, can't remember a time that I've seen a response from board members to refute that, you know, either misinformation or an outright lie. Are you restricted from responding?
No, no, we're not restricted from speaking, and that's probably some good feedback. You know, there is a hesitancy to have a, you know, what contest in the paper, right? There's a bit of that. And when I was running the campaign on Tip Tier, we did put out articles that refuted some of the misinformation that's out there. That's an article. That's probably a good idea. Maybe you need to grow a stronger spine on that and refute that. But that's an important distinction to, you know, as board members, and sometimes even more human and more fallible, we don't have the luxury of misrepresenting things to you guys. We can't do that. We can't spin things. We can't do falsehoods. We can't do that. We are obligated to the best of our ability, this duty of care, to present to you the facts as we understand them to be. It's hard to see the falsehoods and the misunderstandings out there. We do need to do a better job of asserting ourselves appropriately without getting in the mud.
This is kind of a personal thing. I have gone so far as to cut and paste policies and bylaws on Nextdoor. It creates a dialogue, and then it comes like, well, you can change that. That's not the way it is. There's people in this room that come to my defense. There are people in this room that have thanked me for doing that. But I don't know how I can tell the truth any more than that. But it creates dialogue, and it's fun. And I really dislike it also on some of the social media that we've got going around the village. So I have tried to respond. It really is like beating your head against a wall. And that actually hurts, so I quit doing that.
Two things. I don't like social media, so I don't care very much, I don't read it. But the paper has misprinted some things from time to time, and we have worked with them to try to get corrections put in, which they have done. We've even talked about, is there some way that if we see something, to me, if something is printed in the letters to the editor that they know is wrong, if they couldn't call us and say, do you have a couple of sentences you would like to say, you know, what the real issue is here and what it is, that doesn't happen. You know, it has been a problem for many years. We should have two papers here, now we got one, but it's still a problem. Not everything that they write. And today, and in their defense, it's not like those reporters they have I guess you could say they're volunteers. I mean, they make money, but I mean, that's not their background. So, and they go to each of the committee meetings, they come to the board meetings, and sometimes they just don't print the right thing. And unfortunately, people are reading that, and we don't get the corrections put in like we want to. We're looking for suggestions, but that's one of the ones that I think we need to do is those letters to the editors where we know it's outright wrong. If there's some way that we can get our response in before it's sent out to the members, it would be nice.
Yeah, thank you. You know what, I kind of lost track of questions that we have in front of us, so I'm going to ask all of our cooperation in scooting through addressing these upcoming questions. Judy Garcia, do you have a question on policy on POA employee salaries?
Yes, and I had it all written out, but now that we've discussed it so much, already under trust and other things, I think I can condense it a little bit better. Obviously, it's been a controversy over the salary not being available to us. We are the employers, and so I think we should know. But the board has said it's our policy, and I understand what you explained about your responsibility to the policies. So, and also given that we're in a lawsuit, you can't talk about it. But what I want to know is, since there's obviously negative consequences from the lawsuit, that costs us money, and it does diminish the trust factor because people think you don't disclose the information because you think we won't like it. Is there a plan for that policy to be addressed? and make a change. What is the benefit of not changing the policy, if there is a benefit? Because my point is, the policy creates only negative consequences. So if you can help me understand, are there any positive consequences of that specific policy? And if not, please change it.
Yeah, while we're in lawsuit, we're not actively even talking that topic at all. We're waiting. We're just waiting. So
so you can't even talk about the benefit or non-benefit of the policy itself?
We can, but I don't think it would be well advised while the courts are trying to decide what our legal obligations are here. Yeah, so we'll wait for the courts to rule on that, and hopefully it won't be too terribly long, because the specter of having that cloud over it is not a good thing, right? The legal cloud.
Yes.
We don't have a job description, a grade, pay.
We do have a job description, yes.
Okay, but isn't it, so couldn't the people, us, have the pay grades and from X amount to X amount, X amount, X amount, so on?
You know, in years past, we used to do that.
I'm not saying put anybody's name on it.
Yeah, it says grade 3 is from, you know, 30,000 to 40,000, whatever the case may be. Yeah, like, 7 years past, I don't think that's an unreasonable request. I'm going to continue on through the questions here. Wanda Selman, are you here with regard to infrastructure spending?
Yes, I am. I was just going through the budget, and this is a small item, but I noticed that, you know, we have to repair or change the roof on the Balboa Park lawn. That's in the budget. Balboa Park lawn, that's in the budget. But come June, we'll have this big discussion what to do with the whole clubhouse and golf course. Why would we spend what it is, $10,000 right now on the roof that we may be carrying everything down? And that's probably the good question. Yes.
I don't know that. What does it spend that money prior to making any decision?
Well, it says it's going to come. It's going to happen before June. What? I'm looking at the budget.
That what is going to happen before June? Repairing
the new roof on the Balboa.
It's a capital project. It's a capital project that's listed in the budget. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
But does it say it's going to take place before June?
Well, the way I read it, it did.
We'll look at that separately, yeah, because it makes no sense to anyone in this room that you would repair our roof before you made a final decision on that. So we'll look on that.
And one more thing, the outdoor pool, I think that should be put in that garner. It's a luxury, not a necessity, in my opinion.
Okay.
And we're going to have mountain bike trails put in the village. That's another thing that's in the budget.
Again, liaison to recreation. That's something that the recreation committee was looking into. They actually had a meeting of anyone that might have been interested in it. Found out that we might have two mountain bike people. I mean, actual honest mountain bike people. The single track over rocks and, you know, something I never do in the village. They just opened a multi-million dollar, or at least over $1 million, mountain bike track in Hot Springs. These people, the two that are interested in mountain biking, said, why should we spend the money on a mountain bike trail here when we can drive a half an hour with your bike on top of your car and ride a first-class mountain bike trail? It's really, really a way, way, way back burner. Okay, it's probably not going to happen. Most of the people are road bikers. We've got a real good biking concern in the village, but trying to think of alternative ways, like maybe using the golf course carts or cart paths when that golf course is closed.
Right.
As long as you don't interfere with maintenance, those kinds of things. We've got many multi-purpose trails that you can ride your bikes on. So don't worry about that mountain bike thing and the climbing rock wall. I mean, unless you're really up for it.
I think I do have to go with that horse though. I can't imagine.
Okay, is Susan here? Her question was with regard to marketing. Somebody named Susan. Okay, Tom Blakeman, are you here? I didn't see him. No. The other question about the CEO and her contract. James Woodward, are you here? James has a question about future residents, Gen X, Gen Y, and millennials.
So I'm an author. I moved here in March. I love the village. I'm hoping that the vote is now over and the dysfunction that we have goes away. These meetings are great. So in my gothing, I hear this rumor, or I hope it's a rumor, in different groups. It's not just one. We have baby boomers, Gen X, Gen Y, and then we have millennials. And everybody says, oh, we're going after the millennials. Millennials are 22 to 36 year olds. They probably are starting a career or family, and there's no jobs around here. So are we really going after the millennials to the premier?
Well, no, DMP is.
Well, the millennials are determined, and this is something I'm not totally aware of, but I happened to be watching the Stop channel the other day, and there was a guy on from Phoenix. He says millennials are the largest population we have, and it's in the 30 to 45 range is what he said. He wasn't talking 20 to 25.
That's what Google had.
Huh?
Google had the 20 to 36.
Okay. He said the way the people in the stock market are these 30 to 45 year olds. That's maybe if you're 45, we want to be marketing to those people for sure, 40 to 45, because, or even 35 to 45, because in 10 years, people are retiring in some cases earlier, and we want to get on that. I don't believe we're going to be actively marketing the 20 to 25 year olds, especially so. I don't think we're even 30 year olds for that matter. We are an older community. I'm just saying there's different opinions on what millennials are, I guess is what I'm really saying.
But if I hear the spirit of your question, it's are we taking a market departure in our marketing stance away from retirees and pre-retirees toward millennials and younger? Is that right? And that is what the CMP is currently written says. It says it fairly clearly. I think, I was asking if Nancy had the CMP with her, she doesn't, I don't either, but as I recall, that the 60, oh, you do? Okay.
She said the budget.
No. Anyway, but as I recall, and you can fact check me here in a little bit, but as I recall, it calls for 60-some percent of the marketing dollar to be directed to retirees and pre-retirees, but a significant amount, 30 or so percent, to millennials. Now, I think there's a case to be made that maybe isn't the appropriate balance, but that's CMP as it stands today. As I mentioned earlier, there's going to be three focuses for the board and the CEO, one of which is marketing, and that will come up. This marketing strategy that I talked about, that I'm listening for, marketing strategy, marketing plan, metrics on what we're trying to achieve, I think that will come to a head in those conversations and their schedule for this year.
And that's probably another good way to build the trust, is to try to get that information out.
Fair enough, thank you.
You need to go after the people who are looking to retire in the next year.
Yeah, the pre-retired.
Right. They'll shut down and they'll rent, they'll buy their lot, and they'll stay. You can't just say, I'm going to get 62 or 65.
I believe
it's too late.
I believe 11% is what I'm kind of remembering from part of our marketing, is that 61%+ goes to retirees, a portion goes to the Gen Xers, and that's the 45-year-olds now, and then 11% goes to the millennials. If I could just 1 second here to Wanda, I have gone through the capital expenditure budget, and I don't see Balboa roof replacement. Do you want to look at this?
Yeah. We can talk about that.
I just wanted to get to that question. Yeah. I'll bring this to you and you go look at it.
And after we're done up here, we've got a CMP up here, and let's look at that issue on marketing to millennials. This is one of them. Don't want to take the time at the moment, but we heard your comments. Dave Rousseau has a comment. David, are you here? He had a comment with regard to property owner voting ballot suggestion. Jim Dagner, I know you're here. You commented earlier, board positions on issues.
That's basically what I asked before.
All right. Look at us clip through these. Okay. Lydia. Is Lydia here? Okay.
Any questions?
Yeah, she asks about what new projects are being considered in 2019 and are any budget issues that might interfere in accomplishing these. Bill Panikin? Bill, is he here?
Well, I'm here, but my question is kind of petty, but...
We've got time for one petty question. Bill, come on.
Been here 10 years, been reading the paper for 25 years. And the ACC committee, they've been pretty stringent on what they allow. Brown fences are brown, they paint them brown. Signs are brown and they thin. You know, everything's got to be mellow, and it's great. They do pretty good on this. Then a month or so, I'm going down to Silver Boulevard, and there's our blue sign. It's a 128-foot long billboard sign at pickleball courts. And God bless the pickleball people. So it's blue and white, and I phoned the board, the ACC board, and they said, well, that's a win. You know, it's to stop the wind from blowing there. And they never checked the color that it was going to be. So then they said, so we approved it. I said, with the talk of cities, yeah, we made a mistake. So I said, what I did is they were phoning compliance. So you phone compliance, you phone compliance, and they say, well, the ACC's approved it. I said, there's nothing we can do. I said, yeah, but it's wrong. It's blue and white. It just sticks in your face. They said, well, that's all we can do. And I phoned a board member, and they said, well, we're looking into it. So the bottom line is, does the 130-foot long billboard say, you know, are we allowing now the deviation from what I've seen for 25 years?
I hate to do this, but Buddy is our liaison to the ACC and served in that capacity for a long time. Buddy, do you have any comment to me, or should we take that offline and answer?
Well, there has been a complaint filed.
Okay.
A file that is being looked at.
Okay.
There was a minor problem in the way it was done and the color. But it's all been gone over, and it will come down, and then compliance will make a decision based on what ACC said.
Very good.
Well, David, well, I sent an email also to the on the web there, and I never got a feedback. See, I wouldn't push it. I didn't hear what he's saying right now.
You're the complainer.
No, I'm not.
I just being addressed. It sounds like it's appropriately being addressed. Pat, I'm going to give this lady an opportunity because she hasn't addressed yet.
Well, I'm just mentioning the sign. I see it too. It's blue, and it is an advertisement because it has companies, companies going across.
It's sold sponsorship. Yes, Pat.
I'm just going to say in relation to
sign. Oh,
I did pull in there and look at them, and I get what they're for, you know, the wind. The vendor that's on the Remax and the other one, they would have done the same thing if it had been small and in a corner. You know what I'm saying? The pickleball people know that they're supporting them. It didn't have to be this coolly banner.
It didn't have to be blue.
My understanding is that they tried very hard to match the pickleball courts, okay? And they actually serve the purpose of windscreens, and each of these sponsors paid for those windscreens. You didn't. The POA didn't. So it was their initiative to go out and get the, you know, name branding windscreens.
I get that, but then within the restraints of the POA, or, you know, our village, And other places, you know, we talk about brown fences. Well, if you go up on the dam, you know, they're not going to be brown fences. They're going to be the standard silver fences. So sometimes it looks to people maybe like the POA is not following their own stuff.
But it's being addressed. I mean, I think Buddy acknowledged that there was a problem, and it's going through proper processes to address it.
Okay, so it wasn't quite as petty after all.
The protective covenants that were passed with the CMP, I know there's been a lot of complaint about them, and they're constantly being worked on and updated. But the point of those is to take interpretation and personal preferences out of the decision making. And we've got a long way to go because those protective covenants have only been in place since last April. And they have been changed multiple times, and they will continue to be changed. Maybe they're too strict here, maybe they're not strict enough here. But the purpose of those protective covenants was to take the personal opinions out of the decisions. And we've got to appreciate that. I mean, I do.
Sometimes it can go from too little to too much. I mean, that's a common flaw.
Bill,
almost anything we're working on.
Does the covenant say that signs and ads should be brought home or not? Defenses?
I don't know, but I bet Buddy would be happy to chat with you after that because he knows those. I don't know the details of the covenants at that level to know. Yes, sir.
I'd like to make one comment about this. It's a combination of trust, marketing, and recruiting when it comes to the protective covenants. First of all, it went from 30 pages to 151 pages. That's factual. I'm not making that up. No one got to vote on it. I mean, I'm talking about the POA, the property owners. Okay? It was just something that's thrown out there. One of the things, I've attended the architectural committee meetings, and it's a very respectable group. I'm very impressed with them. I thought he was there also. And I talked them to their face. And listening to the way the question was asked, the way the question was answered, and I felt good. I really did. And that's why I found out what the attorneys are here to do in pages. Now, one of the things that they shared with me was that in the protective evidence, there was a bunch of consultants and a bunch of other people that threw a lot of things at and see what stuck to the wall. My choice of words. But that's kind of what it sounded like, because one of the things was you can only build a house with a single car or garage door. That was one of the protective covenants. So you didn't have multiple doors or anything, you couldn't have one in a single car. That was a loose. They fixed it. Okay. Now, to get to the point, I had some new neighbors down the street from me. They put in a very small, almost invisible fence on the front of their porch to keep their dogs from running out. Okay? They moved here from California recently. They were intact. Couldn't understand why they had here this little, almost invisible fence when all the other neighbors had nice doggy fences and everything else. And I'm not advocating for or against either one of these. But what happened was, you got people that live here in California, you've got an overreach, and I do mean a significant overreach in some of these covenants. You think they're going to recommend anybody to move here from California, which is a fertile ground for recruiting? Secondly, I've got four friends that live in California and Oregon. Idaho. They're being overrun by Californians looking for another place to go. Okay? Now, with this overreach, I cannot send my friends a copy of the voice. I cannot. Dr. Barnum asked me the other day, got a really wants to move here, 30-year friend. And he says, I know you've researched it. I know it's a good thing because you and your brother and your mother-in-law all moved here. Okay? We got three houses here because I accidentally found the village when I drove up Danville Road. We had lived for a year for a place to retire. And we had plenty of time to look. And we finally one day said, let's quit looking and let's go to the springs, the hot springs, to the tubs, to downtown. That was we were on vacation. We were looking. We did driving all over the country looking for a place to retire to. Accidentally went up Edinburgh Road, accidentally found it. I found the little sign that said go away to the West Gate. Went to the West Gate. We're here. Now we got or rather down the street from it, but in all the other end. That's all good. But if these covenants with this overreach were in there at the time we bought, I guarantee you, there'd be three of us that wouldn't be here now.
I agree.
And my brother right now is seriously thinking he's got a $1 million house on the lake. And he's very seriously thinking about moving because of these restrictions. I don't have a problem with restrictions that are reasonable.
Yes.
But when you're going so far that, I mean, it's like, I'm not going to start quoting, but I'm just saying, when it goes so far that it's absurd, something that is not an issue.
That makes sense.
It really, really needs to be looked at from not only what I said, but the examples I gave where you're running people off.
Right.
Amen, brother.
Thank you.
But I think those are excellent discussion. I can't talk anymore. I think they're excellent points. I think an email to possibly Buddy as the liaison to ACC or to the chairman of the ACC committee. I know that they'll be willing to talk with you if what your suggestion is valid and can be done. It's a work in process, really it is.
You didn't make a nice comment on it, because I don't get wrong.
You did all that, right?
I did talk to the current CEO, personal, face-to-face. He knows me on a first name basis. I tried to be very respectful when I talked. I did not get anywhere near a response, period. That's all I'm gonna say. Okay. I talked to Buddy in the ACC meetings, and I believe that it's going to very slowly change, but it's going to be faster. And I'm not just talking to just one person, but the way I'm talking to the appropriate people, down to you, you're asking.
Yeah, I'd like to take a moment to talk about a newly approved process for changing the protective covenants that might be helpful here a little bit, and to maybe do just a little fact adjustment. Originally, the protective covenants was 3 pages, and it was part of the declaration. It was just a sketchy thing. Clearly not instructive enough for the ACC to be able to do their job. So they had a lot of supplemental stuff that they put together that aided them in doing the work that they needed to do. However, the only way that protective covenants can change is through a board vote. Well, the protective covenants, as I said, was only 3 pages, and there was no need to change anything on those 3 pages, but all of this stuff that ACC was doing, I'm sure most of it, if not all of it appropriate, but it was out of the sight of the board. And so one of the objectives was to get all of the processes and decision-making documentation that the ACC was using combined with the protective covenant as it existed before in its 3 pages and put it in one document that the board has oversight to changing. So how does that document get changed? You're right, it's 100, well over 100 pages, you're right. So how does that document get changed? There was no process for changing the document. So back in August, this board, the governance committee that I chair, led the definition of this process change. And what it says is the ACC, in doing its work, when it discovers that some portion of that new 100 and whatever page document needs changing, then they address the need for the change, and it is taken up by a group of four. The four people include the ACC board liaison, currently Buddy, the ACC staff liaison, which is Stephanie Hepper, the CEO, and the ACC board chair, which is currently John Froning. If the four of them agree that the protective covenants needs to change, then they write it up, they bring it to the board, and the board considers approving the change or not. So it's a very controlled process now, where it wasn't controlled before. You're right to acknowledge it could be slow, but my point in bringing all that up is change is going to happen at the ACC level. Go to anybody that feels they need to see change in those protective covenants, they should direct their concerns to the ACC because that's where change will originate.
So are you guys the ones that voted, those four people voted over 30 pages, over 100 pages? How did that, where was that?
That was the prior board, and maybe Mike wants to speak to that because that took place in the April meeting.
That's 70 extra pages.
Yeah, it was because they were changing the protective covenants, right, from the 3 pages to the 120 pages, and that is a board action, and the board took action in April on that, but my.
Well, the changes came mainly from the ACC, their suggestions, and it was adopted at that board meeting. It's like anything else, you look at it, you don't think there's a lot of things to it, ended up being adopted. You know, if we need to make changes, we will.
Wasn't that protective covenants, wasn't that a result of the CMP? It was written by some of the same people that came up with the CMP, and if you read the CMP, it talks about changing protective covenants.
Yep.
One of the main things that does is allow use to demand for these small pocket communities and all that, housing as well as businesses. But that's where it came from. And it was adopted, I think, shortly thereafter the CMP. And if you read the protective covenants, it's obvious it's directed at new developers.
And it's obviously full of boilerplate, like you said.
It's all boilerplate, right.
Yes.
It isn't all boilerplate, because what happens in the ACC meetings is somebody puts in a request for something that never happened here before.
Right.
And they are keeping notes of, we have to put something in these covenants to cover that, because it's up for grabs. There's nothing written anywhere. So there's an ongoing markup in addition to the CMP, and when there's enough put together, then a request is, we need to update this thing. Here's all the stuff we've got so far. So we have people who are trying to put in all metal houses, no garage, no driveway, no landscaping information, not telling you what the material is, nothing. And they have to deal with it. And there's nothing in the documentation that allows them to deal with it. So now you're marking up, and CMP is true. Everything you said is true. But there's more to it than that.
And I will say that I'm sure that ACC does add to that. But a lot of that stuff, I mean, that was part of the CMP. They drafted those two together and went through the
That is the process, though. Exactly what you're describing there. And it, again, goes back to the purpose of taking the personal preference guesswork out of approving a particular project. I mean, Buddy's favorite color is hot pink, so he would like every house in the village hot pink. Now, someone else on the committee might think white is the best color or tan. Well, if Buddy can convince everybody that hot pink is the color, that was the personal opinion and personal judgment that has happened in the past. I really don't know what Buddy's favorite color is, but you get the drift. Is that this document took that personal opinion and decision-making process to a much more detailed level. Those can be changed, and they will be. It is a living document. They will be changed. They'll be, maybe some of them will be more stringent, maybe they'll be less stringent. They will be changed.
I think you might have hit on something. If we could do something really outrageous in the village, really outrageous in some fashion, we could probably get all the coverage we want in terms of attracting people.
You know, you think about national news.
If you come in here with a story, you better believe it.
All right, okay, well, put that comment, I show that one minute left. I'm sorry, I have to apologize to Wanda, because she said the Balboa Cart Barn, and my brain was thinking the Balboa Club, okay? And she's absolutely right, it's in the capital projects. You know, and hopefully it'll get done, but it, you know.
But maybe it should be done if we're going to do, it should be done before June. to make decisions what they want to do with the course and the clubhouse.
Right. But first, let me just apologize that I did not understand that it was about the cart barn clubs, the Balboa Club, and I thought, I don't think we're probably going to rush right into replacing that roof.
Okay, very good. Well, so straight up 11, and true to our word, we're going to disband now, but I, for one, am happy to stick around and talk with whomever would like afterwards. I hope you found this to be beneficial. I personally loved it. February 11th is Forward Together with regard to marketing. February 21st would be a repeat of this, although, perhaps new topics. It will be older topics. So please fill out your slips that are at your table to tell us what it is you'd like us to modify it in this particular forum.